and welcome to Big Deal, a series of events from Manpasand to ILNFS and now even Aarin Capital have really brought to the fore the burning issue of the responsibilities of an auditor and what can be really done to strengthen and enhance the credibility of this institution, which, remember, plays such a pivotal role in being the first layer of watchdog for the investors of the listed companies. Also important to ponder, have we really moved forward from the days of Satyam, which was more than a decade back? Let's discuss this with a panel of professionals who have their skin in the game joining me here in the studios. Let me introduce Dinesh Kanabar, Sudhir Soni here in Mumbai studio, Mohandas Pai joining us from Bangalore, and Amarjit Chopra is joining us from New Delhi. Gentlemen, so good to have you on CNBC TV 18. My first question to Mr. Kanabar: have we hit a crisis situation? How do you see the present scenario and how is the auditor community going to deal with it?
I don't think we have hit any crisis situation. What happened was we had firms of chartered accountants doing audit of listed companies, and India probably historically, Nisha, had a very small proportion of big four doing listed companies compared to anywhere in the world. So globally, if you see the listed companies, more than 90 if not 100% of the companies are really audited by the big four. In India, we had a situation where many small firms continued to work with their audit clients. Then came the rotation. And the rotation actually saw what was maybe unintended, where the big four started to look at and get more and more audits, and their domain of audit practice increased. We have then seen a series of situations where people have not agreed with the audit companies on the principles that they have followed. And that has led to, as you rightly mentioned, firms stepping down, resigning, etc. Earlier, they could do so without assigning reasons. Now, they are required to give reasons. And today, we have issues, ILFS, etc., which are still under investigation, but already probably the goose is around the auditor's neck without probably even completing an investigation. So on the one hand, we had Satyam, where probably it took 10 years, as you mentioned, to reach any conclusion. And now, maybe even without a proper investigation, we are seeking to ban the auditors. And it's not necessarily an Indian issue. If you look at UK, if you look at USA, everywhere there are so-called audit failures. And they need to be addressed, and there are answers which need to be found, not necessarily only in India, but also globally.
Oh, yes, that's a fair point, that it's not just an India-specific issue. But let me take it across to Bangalore, to Mohandas Pai. Now, help me understand, we all saw and dealt with the Satyam crisis. At that time, more than a decade back to now ILNFS, what could have been done differently? Could we have averted this kind of a situation?
Well, I don't think we could have averted this kind of a situation till the crisis blew up. Because these kind of crises, I say, is a crisis, not a regular crisis, not a permanent crisis, will happen from time to time. Audit failure is going to happen, will happen in future, because management and auditors get too close together. Now look at ILFS. They were part of the same cozy club. They got consulting money. They got tax money. They helped them restructure. They got everybody around. There were deep conflicts of interest. The balance sheet was totally bad, and the auditors did not qualify, did not look at it. And if you look at the data that's come about certain loans, you find out they knew about it and they hid it. So what do you say? There's collusion. Look at Satyam. There was collusion. The key is, how do we respond to it? Do we appropriately punish the firm to make sure it doesn't happen again? See what happened to Arthur Anderson, right? Arthur Anderson was banned. See what happened to PwC. In India, SEBI banned PwC, so PwC pulled up his socks. The key thing is, how do regulators react? How do they bring them in line? And more than that, how do the Institute of Chartered Accountants pull up these people? I think the ICAI has to take a blame too, because they're behind the curve. They're working on a 19th century architecture. This is not, this is the 21st century. All over the world, the disciplinary part of the profession is being handled by independent bodies. The accounting standards are by independent bodies. Now, everything is in one body and is not working. They take too much of time. They're not proactive enough. They don't take action. And they do not give confidence to the public. So I think it depends on how we handle this. This is going to happen again and again. There are a lot more. Let me tell you, I mean, I study balance sheets. There are a lot more areas. Now, they're quietly resigning and going away because they know what is going to happen. If you investigate all cases where they resign, in many cases, you find that they're also party to some things. And I think it's dangerous. Lastly, there is a concentration risk that's happening to India after the audit rotation. Concentration risk. If you have only four firms doing 95% of the Nifty 50 or the Nifty 200 or 100, whatever it is, and one of them is slapped with a penalty or one of them gets into trouble, we are in trouble.
Let me take it to Amarjit Chopra joining us from New Delhi. And there were some pertinent questions being raised by Mohandas Pai on the kind of responsibilities that have been taken by the Institute. Amarjit Chopra, what do you think could have been done effectively to strengthen the audit fraternity over the last decade and maybe 2 years since Satyam broke?
Let me say one thing very clearly, that it is the auditing profession for the last one decade which has been taking the entire flak. Unfortunately, people are not talking about the promoters, they are not talking about the directors, they are not talking about the bankers, they are not talking about the valuers, they are not talking about the rating agencies, they are not talking about the role of the RBI, etc., etc. Yeah. I don't want to get into those kind of debate, but definitely one thing is very sure. Yeah. After all, if I look at the various advances or loans which have been given by the banks today, I can tell you there are cases, let these be gone into by the concerned agencies,
yes,
where the banks have advanced loans where actually the sales were going down. For the last 5 years, the projections were much higher, and the loans have been given, very frankly, and there has been too much of an expansion in even in those cases.
Right.
The auditors brought those out in the long-form audit report somewhere.
Right.
No, just one minute. We brought it out in the long-form audit reports. The RBI remained silent on those issues. So far as ICAI is concerned, I will not absolve ICAI of the entire blame. There is no doubt about it. There have been certain number of years where we did not progress in the discipline matters. But there have been certain very, very good years, I can tell you, where the progress has been made tremendously in the disciplinary cases. Today, the ICAI has got five benches, and those five benches, each of those benches contains government nominees. And unless one of the government nominees is present, the quorum is not complete. So it is not that the cases, at least in the bench that I sit on today, very, very frankly,
right,
in these last 3 months or 4 months, we have completed more than 50 cases, very frankly. So which other organization, which other institute has actually done it? Let's take the case of the Bar Council, let's take the case of the Medical Council, let's take any other case. Which other council has ever held any of their members guilty? We have been doing it. There are four cases, at least in my knowledge, where we have held the members guilty for the lifetime. We have debarred them for the lifetime.
Right.
We, unfortunately, those cases don't come to the limelight at all.
So, Mr. Chopra, I am not absolving
the institute of the entire blame.
Right. Right. So, Mr. Chopra, let me ask you then very quickly that ICAI has also criticized the big four firms and has taken it to the government. Now, what do you have to say about that? Why blame it only on the big fours?
Let me be very clear about it. To me today, it's not a problem of big four or non-big four. I think when I look at the entire level of NPAs in the banking industry today of 11 lakh crore, which has been declared, and I think another 11 to 15 lakh crore which may be declared in the periods to come, these are not the balance sheets which have been signed only by the big four. There are non-big four people also who are involved.
Yeah.
I think it will be wrong to divide the profession onto these lines of big four and non-big four today.
Right.
We must look at the entire profession as a whole, and we must do a lot of self-introspection, what requires to be done so far as the auditing is concerned. I have been saying it and I will continue to say it. Probably the old maxim which used to say that auditor is a watchdog and not a bloodhound does not hold good today. Somewhere or the other, We have to start re-looking at the entire auditing standard, particularly with regard to fraud, that is SA 240.
You made a very, very pertinent point that are they just the watchdog? They will look at the balance sheet of the company, or they have to be bloodhounds and investigate the matter as well. Is too much responsibility and accountability also being put on that? I want to take that forward, but let me first get in Sudhir Soni also in the discussion. Sudhir, I played a devil's advocate when I was posing that question to Amarjit Chopra. But then, do you not think that now the entire scenario is putting a lot of responsibility on the big force because of the spate of events that have really hit you in the past few months?
Yeah, I agree, Nisha. I think there is a significantly enhanced responsibility. And I think what Mr. Chopra alluded to earlier, what we classically call the expectation gap, that certainly needs to be bridged if the profession has to stay relevant. We can't be saying that we are certifying financial statements, we are not looking for fraud, and if it's incidentally come across fraud, then we deal with it. I think the standards have to be upgraded, and the best part is we today have the tools and the technology to do more penetrative audits, and I think we should do that. At the same time, I must caution that we can't become bloodhounds on every audit, then no audits will get done, and you also need, you know, time of response and so on. So I think that will be counterproductive, and there has to be an I think element of balance in that expectation. But I also agree that we can't have the defense of the watchdog any longer.
But while I am not even discounting the fact that there could have been some connivance or some negligence to that effect, but then there are certain instances in which there have been overcautiousness also by the auditors. Do you agree with that? Now that you have come under fire, there is overcaution and therefore the increasing instances of resignations as well.
No, I would never blame someone for overcaution. I would rather be, if I was to be faulted, I would be rather faulted for being overcautious than for being adventurous as an auditor. Maybe that's how we are as auditors.